My name's Anthony Tamburri. I'm Dean of the John D. Calandra Italian American Institute, and I'm delighted to begin our season with this event. This is an extremely, I think, significant event for something like an Italian American Institute. We're dealing, obviously, with writers, in this case, writers of African in a broad sense, because you'll hear that they're actually from three different geographical areas here. Writers of African descent who were born in, at least our writers here were born, two were born in Italy, raised in Italy. And we have two other very curious, significant combinations in both Candice, who is to my immediate left, and to her left, Camilla Hawthorne, and you'll hear from them their stories. But this is when we were in conversation, and I said to some friends that I was really intrigued by the title of the book, because when I saw the book, Future, il domani, narrato dalle voci di oggi, because we're here in the United States and our lingua franca is English, there was a moment where I thought, gee, are they playing off on words so much so that it's future? You know, well, of course, I don't think it is. We don't know. We can never know what the intentionality of the text is, right? And we don't want to ask the author what the intentionality of the text is, because Roland Barthes told us the author died back in 1968. So, but in all kidding aside, future, future voices, right? So future voices, tomorrow narrated by voices of today. And it's hard to describe or pinpoint the genre here because they are stories. It's sort of essays. They're sort of stories and essays. And I think perhaps that notion of creative nonfiction might be a good label if we need to put a label onto these stories. So we're going to proceed with Candice, I should say. Let me just set the stage here. Candice is the reason why we're here. Candice wrote a very long review of this book on a website called The Dreaming Machine / La Macchina Sognante. And we found out this afternoon, while we had already met, we had chatted about this, we found out this afternoon that the founder, I knew who the founder was, that the founder of The Dreaming Machine, La Macchina Sognante, is a mutual friend. So Candice will talk to us a little bit about the book as someone looking at it from the outside. Camilla wrote the preface to the book. Camilla, you'll hear from her. Camilla is quote unquote American, perhaps just about as American as Candice is in many ways, but you'll hear her story as well. She wrote the preface, and there we found another sort of common bond here, is that we both did our doctorate in the same place, and we both hung out in Berkeley, different decades, but we hung out in Berkeley. Marie and Angelica, instead, are Italian. They are, and I'm going to use the term that Joe will appreciate very much, they are real Italians. They are real. We spoke about that notion of what's an Italian, what's a real Italian, and so on and so forth. So they contributed pieces of creative nonfiction to the book. They're two of the contributors beyond the preface, the introduction that Camilla wrote. So they will follow each other. You guys will just follow each other. They already know what, well, I suggested what they should do. I'm going to give them free rein. And they prefer to speak at the table from the table. So it's more of a chiacchierata than a lecture.
Thank you for coming, everyone. I'm so glad that you're all here and that there's a full room and an appetite to learn more about Future. My general presentation of Futures will be very brief because I would love for you all to just hear more from the authors, three of the 11 authors of the anthology. I'm going to just share with you all what Future is, give you an assaggio or a taste of the percorso or of the journey throughout Future, and then just also share how I got started studying Italian. So Future is an anthology of 11 racconti, or stories, written by Afro-Italian woman. The editor is Igiaba, Scego, and if I'm not mistaken, she recruited each of the contributing authors to write about their experiences. And so Anthony gave us a brief intro to the title, Future, il domani narrato dalle voci di oggi. And in each of the racconti, you, as a reader, as someone external, you are able to experience you're able to learn from each of the women's experiences, and also get a sense of the values in a new Italy, a new world that could be imagined. And in the editor's note, Igiaba calls it the modern day Jacuzzi by Emile Zola. And essentially just how for Emile Zola, the letter that he wrote was calling out the injustices that he was witnessing, and Future is exactly that. It's calling out those injustices and systematic oppressions that exist in Italy, or giving them a name, I should say, not necessarily calling out, but more giving a name. And Future is an extremely important novel, extremely important anthology, as it's the first anthology written by Afro-Italian women. And it's building new spaces for voices that previously were not centered in Italy. So whether that be the publishing and editorial space, to media and politics even, and each of the stories just focus on different aspects, so not solely gender and race, but also histories of connecting colonialism to contemporary citizenship debates, and homemaking, also mental health. And the reason for why I'm interested in Future is, as an African-American woman, I believe there is, at least in terms of race studies, a fair amount of privilege being an African-American woman learning about, and there's a lot to learn from Afro-Italian women, and I think it's really important to build that ponte fra le diaspore, or bridging the diasporas, and really learning from each other to help build the world that we want to see. So I'm just gonna quickly break down the racconti into three main buckets to give you a taste, and then Camilla, Marie, and Angelica will dive deeper into their stories. So when I wrote the article for the Dreaming Machine, thanks to Pina Piccolo, the founder of the Dreaming Machine, or the Macchina Sognante, I highlighted that there are three main categories. One, citizenship, homemaking, and mental health that are explored in the racconti. So to start, some of those stories focus on, they explore the political anxieties about blackness that exist currently in contemporary Italy, and how those are experienced. One book that I really appreciated and that resonated with me in the past is Bianco e Nero, Storia Razziale, by Lombardia Diop Giuliani, which takes readers through a historical construction of race in Italy, and shows readers how colonialism in Italy started first within the peninsula and then expanded to Africa. And as those practices were happening, there's this self-reflective color blindness that's constantly in juxtaposition to the other. So internally and constantly in juxtaposition to who's considered darker in the south, outside of the peninsula in relation to Africa. So in Pesarini's and Angelica's story, in Non si intravede alcuna speranza, one piece that I noted in the story is how the Maddalena, the prima futura, as Angelica describes her, the protagonist, her blackness throughout the story is perceived as something that's
to be removed and not taken care of. And so Angelica will touch on that more specifically in her own words. And then in Marie Moise's story, Marie here will share more later, Abbiamo pianto un fiume di risate, her story also explores the generational trauma of the one drop rule, which is not limited to Italy. Anywhere in the African diaspora, there's the one drop rule. So that's something I was calling to before in terms of the connections between the diasporas or the ponte fra le diaspore. And then in Esperance Rapanti's story, she writes about a young man who is witnessing the tragedies and murders of African men such as Idijen and Ibrahim Mane, and feeling as if it's not going to touch him. And she looks forward to 2039 and imagines extermination of black folks getting removed from their homes. And so you see how there's this trend of, or this theme of political anxieties about blackness that's explored in the different racconti. And then transitioning into another main bucket of the stories is just general discourses about citizenship and practices and debates about citizenship. So something that is very familiar to folks is the question, ma come mai parli l'italiano così bene? A question that is ultimately interrogating not just where you're from, if you want to put it into a bucket, or something that can be confined, but also essentially your humanity. And we, in her essay, Che ne sarà dei biscotti, uses cookies as a metaphor to explore how we're all, you can't confine a human being, and we're all mixed, and it's really important to interrogate the language that you use to dehumanize someone. And then moving into Alessia Herrero's story, Pure c'era un odore di pioggia, the protagonist is a young Cape Verdean woman living between, who's returning to Rome, her home, and she explores this two-ness of not being home in Rome, not being home in Cape Verde, and the ways that she's constantly attacked by that against her body with her documents and people calling out, you know, you're not from here because you don't have this document, even though she's been living in Italy her whole life. Also just in terms of body politics, not passing through facial recognition cameras because of her skin tone and the darkness. So realities that are very real to folks, not just solely in Italy, but across the diasporas. And then also in terms of, and then just transitioning now into homemaking, there are stories that talk about how belonging and building belonging at home is a uniquely Italian experience. So in Incanto della Memoria, that explores spirituality and rituals at home to build one's home in a new country. Even if that country's been yours for years, the regular practices that you do to build that home in that place. In Il mio nome by Giara Khan, she explores how learning about her family's heritage and the history of words, specifically with names, was a tool for her to challenge the experiences of racism that she's had in Italy and essentially make herself be comfortable in who she is in living in Italy. And then La Maratona Continua by Addis Tesfamarian expands on just a consciousness on a race and legality. She's from Milan, and she went to Amsterdam for school, and she explores how she was able to learn so much more about the Eritrean community in Amsterdam, even though her roots are from Eritrea. And so her experience was very similar to, it was an amazing story about how she was able to learn about our trains and just see the relatedness between her experience as an Italian woman with Eritrean roots in Italy and connecting that to Eritrean refugees in Amsterdam. And then next, I just want to highlight how mental health is explored, as we're currently, there are consistently more conversations about mental health in Black communities, and the book does, the stories do touch on that. So for example, in Marie Moise's story, she explores how her own process of healing, of overcoming generational trauma of racism has impacted her, and specifically that process of healing through remembrance and community. In the Santanga, in that story there, I'd just like to highlight that the author goes through her experiences of becoming in Italy and her relationship with her father and her family, and how her as well as her colleagues or her classmates from school had to really unlearn the things that they were taught about themselves and get the knowledge that they needed from books and just study to become their own doctors, to become their own psychologists. Because even when she would go to the psychologist, Leticia, that's the author, she cited in the story how the psychologist would say to her, you know, your mother shouldn't make yourself a victim because that would hinder her integration. So things like that where you're trying to take care of yourself, but you're experiencing these prejudices while you're doing so. And then lastly, in Najak Bai's story, the La Veglia dell'Ultimo Anno, she explores the dealing of grief, experiencing grief of her recent young cousin's passing. And it's a really beautiful story to just see how she's processing that in community. And it's something where I view it as it's a very unique experience and a very uniquely Italian experience as well. And that's just a quick percorso assaggio of the book. So there are some copies here. Please feel free to get one. The book is a great book, and it really is just a testament to how Afro-Italians, especially Afro-Italian women, are really tackling systems of oppression. There was an event in Italy this past fall called Il Bianco e Nero, Le Parole per Dirlo, and it was a convegno or conference for folks to really unpack these experiences related to the systematic oppression and giving names. And Camilla had the honor of giving we gave an introduction to the event, and to quote her, Afro-Italians cannot breathe in Italy because there's just so much tension and trauma that and violence that exists. And Future is really a book that allows folks to know that non-white Italians don't have to bear all the burden themselves in doing anti-racism work, and that there's a lot to learn from white Italians as well, or folks who may not find themselves juxtaposed against, and that when you do anti-racism work, that you don't want to have that your work meet your needs first. You want to make sure it meets the needs for the folks that you're advocating towards. And so Futur is a really great tool for folks to learn to do that work. And so I'm really excited to be here with you all. And I'm going to pass it off to Camilla.
Thank you all so much, and again, a huge thank you to Candice for really, you know, being the glue that brought us all together. This is my first time participating in a presentation of Future, so it's really an honor to be here. So, I began to understand my own Blackness in Italy. I was born in Northern California in 1987 to an African-American father from Oakland and a white Italian mother from Trescore, Bergamo. My parents, Edward and Giliola, met in Italy in the 1970s, where my father had been stationed for military service. They married in the snowy mountains of Trentino in 1976, at a time when there were very few couples like them in Italy. And although they eventually settled in the United States, they insisted that I be raised in an environment where I would learn to value both my African-American roots and my Italian heritage. So I grew up bilingual in English and Italian. I actually spoke Italian before I spoke English. And I have really fond memories of, you know, bedtime stories from books of African folklore, African-American history, and, you know, favole italiane. Every summer, and often in the winters, my parents took me back to Italy to spend time with my aunts and my uncles and my cousins, who are spread still across Trescore, Sacile, Gais. My mother was the only one in her family to come to the United States. So I took my first wobbly toddler steps in Italy. I have incredibly fond memories of chasing fireflies and collecting elderflowers to make sciroppo di sambuco and gathering fresh eggs on my mother's family farm in Trescore. So as a kid, this kind of transcultural life was pretty banal. It was entirely unremarkable to me that I spoke two languages, that I had two passports, that my parents were two colors. But as I grew up, I realized that I was actually really fortunate to be raised by parents like mine and that the rest of the world wasn't quite as open-minded as the family that I came from. So in California, when my mom enrolled me in public school, she wrote on the paperwork that I was bilingual and I was almost put into remedial English classes. My white friends would joke that I wasn't really black until I started outperforming them in school, at which point they claimed that I was receiving special treatment because I was black. In Italy, my mother was often peppered with questions about what African country she adopted me from. When my father and I would go out for coffee together in Italy, we would often notice older Italian men gossiping about us in Italian, but of course they shut up as soon as we switched our conversations into Italian. And of course, wherever I went, I was asked the same question, which we've all faced, right? Where did you learn to speak Italian so well? But for me, over time, I started to see more people of African descent in Italy, and I was seeing more people who looked like me, I was seeing more families that looked like my family, and I was totally enthralled. I wanted to know, who were these other Afro-descendants in Italy? How did they get to Italy? What were their stories, and what did we have in common? And so, when I started my undergraduate degree, I started studying the history of the African presence in Italy, the dynamics of African immigration to Italy, part of this long-standing desire to knit back these two parts of my identity that the rest of the world had said were mutually exclusive. And then when I started a PhD in geography in 2012, I learned about the Ius Soli movement in Italy, the movement for a reform of Italian citizenship law away from a blood or descent-based citizenship system toward citizenship based on birthplace, a movement that has really been spearheaded largely by people of African descent, although not only, and people who are around my own age. And so as I started traveling around Italy, conducting interviews and going to meetings and organizing events, I was struck by all the ways our stories intersected. Right, stories of multiple belongings and non-recognition, stories of anger and frustration, but also stories of everyday resistance and hope, stories of what Du Bois called double consciousness. Of course, it's also important for me to note that our stories weren't identical. Right, I carry the privilege of moving through the world with an Italian passport thanks to the same citizenship law that disenfranchises so many of my black Italian comrades. And I also have the benefits conferred to me by carrying an American passport, having US citizenship. But I also can't overstate how much I've learned from my Afro-Italian sisters and brothers over the years. So I carried out the majority of the research for my dissertation, which is now on its way to becoming a book, in 2016, right, a year that was rocked by global anti-black violence and xenophobia, the rise of far-right parties, and a clear and frightening resurgence of racial nationalisms. And my soul was nurtured during this time by my beloved Afro-Italian comrades. They showed me the multiplicity of African diasporic resources. They taught me new ways to practice community. They revealed the possibilities of community formation that challenged exclusionary identities and ethnic absolutisms. They showed me that there was room for my Italianness in Black America and room for my Blackness in Italy. I get really emotional thinking about it, sorry. This book is historic, as Candice alluded. It's the first collection of writing by Afro-Italian women. The stories contained in this book are part of a new wave of organizing by young people in Italy around Afro or Black Italianness. There's been an African presence in Italy for centuries, but Italy really only became a major site of African immigration in the 80s and 90s. And the children of that first generation of immigrants have come of age. They've grown up in Italy understanding themselves to be Italian, but not being recognized by the wider society as such. They've endured racist humiliations at the hands of high school teachers or classmates, stereotypical representations in the media, and in many cases, the labyrinthine bureaucracy of the Italian naturalization process. And these sorts of shared experiences have sparked a growing identification with the categories of Black or Afro as frameworks for collective political organizing. These emergent conversations and debates about something called Black or Afro-Italianness began to take coherent form on blogs and social media platforms like Facebook in the early 2010s as young people formed spaces for discussion and community building that could overcome the spatial dispersal characterizing many Afro-descendant communities in Italy. And their conversations about the commonalities among Afro-descendant youth in Italy, similarities that often transcend national origin, emerged against the background of an uptick in explicit xenophobia, racism, and anti-Black violence. Through modalities like direct political activism, new media, literature, and film, they have campaigned for remembrance of Italy's colonial history and its legacies in the present, mobilized for citizenship, challenged dominant conceptions about who counts as Italian, valorized Black beauty and African aesthetics. They're challenging the idea that Blackness and Italianness are mutually exclusive, and that racism is just an American phenomenon with no connection to Italy's own history of national formation and overseas expansion. And they're building new bridges, as Candice said, connecting Afro-Italian struggles with other mobilizations in Italy for the rights of precarious workers, women, refugees, and other struggles around the world. And Afro-Italian women, in particular, have played an outsized role in these mobilizations. Online discussions about the politics of Afro-textured hair have helped to catalyze broader discussions about what it means to be a Black woman in Italy. In these spaces, Afro-Italian women came together to appreciate one another's beauty, challenge Eurocentric beauty standards, and discuss their everyday experiences of gendered racism in Italy. The emergence of a powerful Black feminist politics in Italy could be seen most recently in an open letter to Corriere della Sera criticizing an offensive image of Milan's mayor Giuseppe Sala with a Black girl sitting at his feet. In a powerful statement of solidarity, which Angelica, you were part of that. Marie, were you also involved in the letter? But Angelica was one of the signatories. In this powerful statement of solidarity, each of the statement's authors signed the letter simply as Donna Nera. So I think it's also important to situate this book in a broader diasporic context alongside other influential Black feminist collections like All the Women Are White, All the Blacks Are Men, But Some of Us Are Brave, and Showing Our Colors, Afro-German Women Speak Out, which was one of the first texts to explore Black German histories and experiences, and is today credited as playing a pivotal role in launching the broader Afro-German feminist movement. And the fact that we're all sitting around this table also makes me think of Kitchen Table, Women of Color Press, right? And the kitchen table as this space of consciousness raising and collective transformation. So texts like these, like this book, are also much needed reminders to decenter the United States in the kind of stories that we tell about the African diaspora. It's important to invert the kind of teleological narrative that Blackness and Black politics begin in the United States and then emanate outwards to influence the rest of the world, including Black Italians who are seen as merely on the margins of the diaspora. It's true that the U.S. has one of the largest Black communities outside of the African continent, although Brazil's is the largest, and that African Americans have particularly deep histories of collective mobilization, and that African American culture and politics have influenced the entire world. But we have to resist the narrative that all other Black communities have to catch up to and copy the African American experience. And indeed, Angela Davis told the Italian-Eritrean journalist Kibra Sabhat after a lecture in Bologna in 2016. She said, "Yes, I think it's true that our experiences are different. Americans of African descent have experienced a long struggle different from the rest of the world. But still, it's important for us to connect with each other, to communicate amongst each other. Often, us African Americans can learn from the experiences of Black Europeans." So what can Black Europe, and specifically Black Italy, teach Black America? Several things come to mind. The origins of racism and racial capitalism lie in Europe, and Italy was not immune. Italian merchants and bankers played an important role in European commercial networks that undergirded the Mediterranean trade and enslaved Africans, a trade that eventually paved the way for the transatlantic slave trade. Italian philosophers and scientists developed theories of racial difference that traveled across the globe, and Italy engaged in extensive and violent colonial ventures in Africa that continue to shape global geopolitics to this day. We can only understand global racisms, including racism in the United States, if we engage closely with the histories of colonialism, capitalism, and racism that emerged first in Europe. In addition, the struggles of Afro-Italian youth are intertwined with matters of immigration, borders, and colonialism. And this should serve as an important reminder to African Americans that our struggles must also take into consideration the experiences of immigrants and colonized people. Racism, colonialism, and border controls are historically intertwined processes, and this can serve as the basis for powerful new solidarities. And perhaps most importantly, the stories of Afro-Italian women in this book are a reminder that African Americans are not alone in our political struggles, and that while the global resurgence of the far right is deeply alarming, we must find hope in the fact that the resistance is global too. None of us is fighting this battle alone, and our struggles are interconnected. So this collection makes a powerful contribution to the growing Afro-Italian community in Italy, to an Italian society that has yet to come to terms with the fact that Italianness is not synonymous with whiteness and Catholicism, and to the global African diaspora. So it's an honor to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Camilla. Thank you, Candice. Thank you, everybody, for being here. And Calandra Institute for inviting us. Girls, I understood the importance of what we did when I met your words. I wasn't effectively conscious of what we did until I read your text, your review, and whoa, did we really do that? Okay. If you're okay with that, I will read you some few lines from my text in Italian. Okay. My title is Abbiamo pianto un fiume di risate. Sono nata in una famiglia sbiancata da uno strappo improvviso. Ho pronunciato le mie prime parole nella lingua per la quale mio padre, le sue sorelle, il padre di mio padre, avevano dovuto dimenticare la propria. Ho ereditato solo un tratto evidente di questa mia stranezza, questo cognome insolito e impronunciabile, Moise, con due puntini sulla I. Ma per il resto, nata da un haitiano mulatto e da una bianca italiana, sono stata cresciuta perché fossi normale tra i normali, proprio come mio padre, mio nonno e zie non avevano potuto essere. Per una vita intera, sono cresciuta senza avere un passato. Hanno preferito tacerlo piuttosto che consegnarmi un passato nero. Eppure, ho ereditato un cognome di origini schiavili. Moise significa Mosè in francese. E il significato etimologico è salvato dalle acque. È uno di quei nomi biblici che i coloni assegnavano ai loro schiavi una volta trapiantati dall'Africa ad Haiti. Con un battesimo di rito cattolico si faceva tabula rasa della vita umana che quei corpi schiavi avevano conosciuto prima della deportazione. Moise, salvato dalle acque. Quale nome più calzante per un corpo sopravvissuto alla tortura di un viaggio transatlantico forzato? Ma una volta arrivati in Italia,
i Moise hanno iniziato a farsi chiamare all'italiana Moise. La pronuncia alla francese, Moise, era riservata per i parenti rimasti dall'altra parte dell'oceano. Tuttavia, la normalità si è eredita per sangue. E anche se mi hanno italianizzato il cognome, ogni volta che a scuola ho dovuto disegnare l'albero genealogico, quelle radici recise rispuntavano fuori e io vedevo nell'espressione stranita dei volti altrui che io normale non ero affatto. Una volta, mentre disegnavo i volti della mia famiglia per un albero genealogico, mia nonna mi ha detto che per colorare il nonno ci voleva il pennarello marrone. L'effetto di quella faccia marrone sul foglio della mia discendenza mi ha fatto realizzare che c'era del sangue nero anche dentro di me. One drop rule. La storica legge razziale che fa di te un nero se erediti anche una sola goccia di sangue nero. Ed ecco che con quella goccia di sangue ereditavo un'intera storia di disgrazia e follia. A 13 anni ho scoperto che mio padre aveva altre due sorelle, oltre a quelle con cui sono cresciuta. Due sorelle più grandi, figli di un primo matrimonio di mio nonno. Avevano lasciato Haiti per gli Stati Uniti e ciascuna aveva avuto 5 figli. Mi sono scoperta all'improvviso cugina di 10 afroamericani. In un quaderno ho trovato la foto della più grande di loro, la bellissima Pascal. Da quel momento in avanti ho cercato di ricevere sporadicamente qualche notizia su di loro. Qualche mese dopo, Pascal è morta di AIDS. Ho sentito la mia nostalgia sprofondare in un abisso. Non avevo fatto in tempo a dirle che la stavo cercando. Ho sentito che Pascal mi mancava da sempre e per sempre mi sarebbe mancata. E alla sua memoria, che non potrò mai conservare, che dedico queste parole. Fin da piccola ho passato tanto tempo sui libri, ma di Haiti non c'era mai traccia. Nessun libro di geografia riteneva saliente la storia di quell'isola, nessun libro di letteratura, figuriamoci di filosofia. È stata nonna a raccontarmi che Cristoforo Colombo arrivò da Haiti il 5 dicembre 1492, trovandola talmente bella da volerla battezzare con il nome di Hispaniola, piccola Spagna. Di Cristoforo Colombo, patrimonio del tutto italiano, mi avevano insegnato ad andare orgogliosa. Così ho guardato Haiti per la prima volta dai suoi occhi e l'ho vista brillare, piena di acqua, fiori e arcobaleni. Una sola volta ho trovato un trafiletto sul libro di storia che con distacco nominava Haiti come la prima destinazione della tratta transatlantica degli schiavi. I Moise sono stati salvati per ben due volte dalle acque. Prima, sopravvissuti alla deportazione disumana per mare, che ha fatto tabula rasa della loro storia, ne ha obliterato la memoria, bandito la lingua materna, spento la forza di desiderare la vita. E poi di nuovo, sopravvissuti grazie alla distanza che il mare ha imposto tra l'Europa, terra di salvezza, e Haiti di Duvalier. Dopo aver lottato e rischiato la vita contro quella dittatura sanguinaria, i Moise sono entrati in clandestinità per sfuggire alla violenza e alla tortura. Nel 1965 hanno lasciato l'isola per sempre e così anche lo sradicamento si è compiuto due volte. Salvati dalle acque, ma di nuovo condannati a non mettere radici nella terra. Ho sentito il bisogno delle radici quando la nostalgia del viaggio ha iniziato a fare male alla mia zia, poi a papà e infine a me. Avevo bisogno di capire perché. C'è la normalità bianca e c'è il suo opposto. Ma il contrario del normale non è semplicemente la normale. La normalità è la condizione di chi ha il potere di farti sentire sbagliato, di sancirti inferiore, di marchiarti come fallito. L'opposto della normalità bianca è il fallimento. Io sono nata bianca da chi ha fallito nell'esserlo. Sono nata e sono stata cresciuta nell'implicito dovere di cancellare il marchio, di nascondere l'indicibile da cui avevo origine, per spezzare così la catena del fallimento. Non ho imparato la lingua di mio padre, non ho mai visto la sua terra, non conosco la sua storia. Sono bianca, ma la normalità è stata la mia angoscia. Mi sento afflitta da una patologia ereditaria. Siamo haitiani. Le ragioni di questa follia stanno dentro di noi. razza di sfaticato, ladro, bugiardo, incapace di badare a se stesso, irresponsabile, incapace di comportarsi davvero uomo, vigliacco in fuga di fronte alle sue responsabilità, come tutti quelli come lui. E la colpa è solo e soltanto sua. I sintomi rendono evidente che la causa è endogena. I Moise sono affetti dalla sindrome haitiana, una patologia inguaribile. I medici hanno fatto il possibile, ma la verità è che loro non vogliono curarsi. E io, che di quello sfaticato irresponsabile sono figlia, presa nella mia bianchezza, dopo aver tanto faticato per trovare le mie radici, adesso voglio reciderle.
Well, when Igiaba Scego asked me to write a piece for this book, I felt as she asked me to look at the future by a pair of eyes which I hadn't had the courage to open for a long time. My Haitian ones. Opening those eyes meant opening myself to the world by a point of view that cannot be reduced to a single coherent one. It has rather to be understood like a place where opposite conflictual visions of the world meet. I remember that when I was a teenage girl and I saw my body turning into a woman's body, I got angry with my white Italian mother for giving me birth with an Italian, Haitian man, and not with an Italian one, as she did for my sisters, who, unlike me, have Italian surnames, blonde and straight hair. And from that standpoint, the world, my country, was a painful world. The same my father suffered from, failing for all his life in attempting to be white. I chose to write this piece because I felt I needed to reopen my Haitian eyes on him and on our relationship and on the non-white sufferance that connects us. My mother tongue, Italian, has no words to define that sufferance. Racism imposed an interior affliction that cannot be named. So it cannot be understood neither by those who feel it or those who don't, or those who perhaps has caused it. That sufferance just doesn't exist, but it does. And even worse, it's when I try to describe it to people that will never have the same experience, and yet the only way to accept what I tell them is to create a parallel, to compare my experience to theirs. That's exactly how racist, colonial, othering processes work. By understanding the world by analogies. Everything is defined by comparing a standard white experience to the rest of the world. When European colonizers ate a pineapple for the first time, they didn't assume it as with its already existing name. They cancelled it, but they thought it was similar to a pine cone, tasting like an apple, and starting from their experience, they called it pineapple. And psychological effects of racism and colonial trauma are like a pineapple. They have no proper names. They can be just defined by comparing it with white psychological experience and understood by analogy. So you feel like me when I was? No. So it's depression? No. Anxiety? No. Schizophrenia? No. Without the words to name it, I learned from my father to pass as white and to choose to close my Asian eyes. And I had the privilege, because I could do it, because I'm effectively perceived as a white Italian, and because I have Italian citizenship, which permitted me to obtain a passport in 5 days to be here today with you, to travel, to study, to access to human rights. And yet, when people treat me as a white Italian, I feel like forced to censor a part of me, to isolate it, and I feel alone. And that's exactly that part of me that hadn't the courage to take the floor, and at the same time, it was keen to do it. And keen to say, I'm not Italian as you are, and I'm still Italian. And I am a white Italian, and I'm not. And my Italianness has nothing to do with our Italian explorer, Christopher Columbus, because actually he is responsible for murders, tortures, dispossession, slavery, which actually my country suffered, because my country is Haiti as well. And I chose to write my piece because when Igiaba proposed me to write, I opened my Asian eyes and I saw the legacy of that colonial trauma that generations by generations and through centuries, through deportations, through exploitation, was delivered to me. It was very difficult to find the words, but I did, because for the first time, I was not alone. When I started to write, I didn't know what my Afro-Italian sisters would have written. I didn't know, but I knew. I knew that we would have spoken out all together. And if I had said, it happened to me, they would have answered in a way or in another, it happened to me too. And so they did. Reading my future comrades' pieces was a great emotion. Reading about their disorientation while looking for roots, for home, for a future. Reading about the same nostalgia for never met people and places. The emptiness and the weight of the double absence. But also irony, laugh, rivers of laugh. This book has a special power, and it is the shared power of the network, of the collective action that supported, welcomed, empowered, embraced us, and gave us the force to dive into the future. Thank you.
Wow, it's hard now. I feel really honored to be here too, as you have said. It's a great pleasure. It's really a great honor, because hearing all of these words in itself is very therapeutic, I think, and it's very healing of different issues that may arise. So, okay. So my story. I'm Angelica Pesarini. And my story is titled Non si intravede speranza alcuna, which in English can be translated as No Hope is Foreseen, something like that. So, and so when Igiaba asked me to write a story for this book, it was a big challenge for me, because I write for work. I'm a professor at NYU in Florence. I'm a sociologist, so I write dry academic essays, I guess. I felt this was important. And in my mind, when I was writing this story, I was thinking about the other writers. I was writing this story thinking about having them in mind. So to contextualize a bit my story, I think I need to start from a child, a girl in the 80s, which is me. So I was born in Rome, but I was raised in Reggio Emilia, Pianura Padana. And I I remember my childhood as a fantastic period of my life, but also a period where I was surrounded and sometimes drowning a bit in an ocean of whiteness, because nobody was like me ever. From the moment I was stepping outside my house, everyone was white everywhere. So from kindergarten to almost university, I never had a non-white student in my class. It was always me. And sometimes I look at my picture in elementary school, there is always this brown spot in the picture, and it was just me. And so I was, I knew who I was, I knew I was Italian, but I was not colorblind, and certainly the people around me were not colorblind. And as a non-white child in Italy, I was exposed to questions that people of children of my age didn't have to answer to, that we've mentioned. So, where are you from? And so saying Rome was basically pointless, because there was this second question, no, but where are you really from? My parents, they kept me quite far from this side of myself. So the question, where are you from, in my case, is also more complicated, because my parents are both mixed and my grandparents are both mixed. And so my family history originated in Italian colonialism. So at the beginning of the 1900s, my great grandfather was among one of the first settlers who went to Somalia, who treated Somalia a bit like a pornotropic in a way. So he had three children who didn't want to recognize. One of them was my grandfather, who took his father to court to get his surname. And his wife, my grandmother, she was born from a fascist father who she never met, and her mother died when she was 7, and so she was raised until the age of 18 in a so-called collegio, that was a sort of orphanage for mixed-race children specifically, run by Catholic missionaries who were sharing the same racist, fascist values that was going on at the time. On the other side, on my mom's side, her father was a communist who escaped from Forlì because he didn't want to stay in fascist Italy anymore, and he went to Africa too. So all of these stories were somehow floating in the air, but nobody was telling them. So I was begging to hear memories and stories, but there was a very heavy silence in my family, which I realized only later that was due to this trauma, to this pain that they didn't want me to suffer. But I needed answer, and so I was growing up, and somehow through my education, I came to term with myself, and so I started to study anthropology. I went to London, and that was a very eye-opening experience for me. And then I went back to Italy, studied anthropology, and then I realized I was really interested in gender studies, but in Italy didn't exist. So I moved again to the UK, where I did a master in gender development and globalization, but I realized the gender side was really what was interesting to me, and I started to work on the representation of African women in the fascist propaganda. And from there, I realized that this story was connected to me. And so I decided to carry on with a PhD. And this PhD was not just an academic experience, was really a life-changing experience, because for the first time I went to Eritrea, and everything started to make sense. Although in Eritrea I was called a white woman because I was read as white, and in Italy, of course, there are other issues. So, but in Eritrea, I finally started to understand that colonialism was a very important part of me and my identity, and there were so many stories about the colonial period that were completely under-investigated and not known at all. And so I started to work on this, and I wanted to work on the oral history of women. So I really wanted to gather the voices of women who were born during the fascist regime from white, usually fascist fathers, and African mothers, like in my family, what happened to them. And so I discovered a number of incredible stories. So that's why when Igiaba asked me to write this story, my first reaction was not using my personal story, but using one of the stories I gathered, because they were so important. They were speaking to me a lot. And so this is that's why I collected this story, the story of Maddalena. This is a real story. So it's me in the story, this person being in East Africa for 3 months, gathering, doing interviews. And then once in a very small archive, I see this picture, and it's the picture of this girl. And her file is pretty big, so there is a lot of documentation inside. And it was quite astonishing, the story of this person. And so I collected these letters, and just to give you an idea, I would like to read you how I met Maddalena, so what was written about her. So I found the letter that was dating 21st of May 1931, and is written by the Vicariato Apostolico di Asmara. And so the letter said, circa 12 anni or sono, dietro interessamento del dottor Laurenti, venivano ricoverati presso questa missione cattolica di Asmara due piccini meticci nativi di Addis Abeba, l'uno di nome Gabriele, nato nel 1915, l'altra di nome Maddalena, nata nel 1913, figli entrambi, ci si disse allora, di certo SM, dimorante ancora attualmente in Addis Abeba. Fino a circa 6 anni fa, detto SM ebbe dell'interessamento per il mantenimento dei due piccini, inviando allo scopo a questa missione cattolica rette mensili, per quanto ridotte. Più tardi si rifiutò di concorrere al mantenimento dei due piccini, protestando, ci si disse, che egli non era per i piccini che un semplice benefattore. Questa missione continuò ugualmente due meticci la sua operazione di beneficenza ed oggi il Gabriele, in età di 17 anni, si guadagna da vivere lavorando come meccanico presso l'officina dell'italiano Gatti. Anche la Maddalena, di circa 18 anni, potrebbe guadagnarsi da vivere perché, oltre ad una buona educazione ed istruzione, è ben addestrata nei lavori di cucito e ricamo, abile assai nell'arte culinaria, brava nel disimpegno di tutte le faccende domestiche, ma si rifiuta ostinatamente di andare a servizio presso qualche buona famiglia italiana. Vorrebbe invece essere impiegata presso qualche ufficio governativo e dallo scopo insiste per uscire dalla missione. Fino ad oggi siamo riusciti a trattenerla, ma alla fine dovremo cedere perché non intendiamo violentare la sua volontà ed obbligarci alla vita di secondini. Dato che detta fanciulla ha manifestato più volte il desiderio di raggiungere il padre in Addis Abeba, pregheremmo perché la delegazione italiana in luogo notificasse al genitore tale desiderio e lo esortasse al ritiro presso di sé o presso parenti della fanciulla. In caso di rifiuto da parte del signor SM, la fanciulla lascerà indubbiamente la missione con la quasi certezza di perdersi, non solo perché è giovane e quindi di nessuna esperienza della vita, ma anche perché di forme avvenenti e di un carattere amabile assai. Sicuri che codesta onorevole direzione vorrà benignamente interessare la delegazione italiana in Addis Abeba per il caso, anticipiamo i più vivi ringraziamenti. Con deferentissima stima mi riconfermo devotissimo segretario del Vicario Apostolico. So this is how I met Maddalena. And after this presentation letter, there were many other letters that one also from her father, and Maddalena never saw that letter. In fact, it was confiscated by the missionaries. But this is to say that the idea of race, blood, and citizenship and identity is a very ancient issues, actually. We think about the fascist regime, but it goes even earlier. It goes from the liberal age, because in 1909 already, if we remember, Eritrea became the first colony in 1890. In 1909, the colonial government has to set up a code chiamato Codice Civile per la Colonia Eritrea, in which one of the issues is what to do with these mixed-race children who have Italian blood, and so they could be Italian because of ius sanguinis. And here we see for the first time how anthropology comes into picture, because the criteria decided was if a child who has unknown father and unknown mother shows signs of Italian blood, can get citizenship. So this is from 1909. And this was the code the fascists used to implement their citizenship law. However, they were a bit more explicit. So the citizenship law in 1933, they said that in order for an orphan child to gain Italian citizenship, they had to show, amongst other things, clear signs of the razza bianca, of the white race. And so we are here in 2020, and still many people deny this nexus race blood citizenship, when to me is very clear. To be Italian is to be white. Our Italianness is challenging, is contested, sometimes is denied. And so it was important for me to show the history of this process. Also, the women I did interview with, you know, they were born and raised in Eritrea and Ethiopia, and they considered themselves Italian because they were speaking Italian. The lucky ones had Italian surnames. And so they experienced a lot of racism in Eritrea because they were not black enough for the Eritrean community. So in the 60s, when the war between Eritrea and Ethiopia, the conflict start to create some serious tension, they all go back to Italy. And among them, there are my respondents. However, they arrive in Italy with this idea of their Italy, the Italy they've been learning at school, where they were studying Dante, Petrarca, Florence. And then they arrive in 1970 Italy. They take a boat, they cross the Mediterranean from Massawa to Naples as Italians with an Italian passport. And when they arrive, obviously they are called other things but Italians. So not only that, they are not Italian, but the colonies, the idea of the Eritrea, Somalia, is completely disappeared. People don't know where Eritrea is. And so there is this double shock, not only not to be seen Italian in your own country, but also your history doesn't exist anymore. And I think this colonial amnesia is such a key point to explain what's happening in Italy today with, you know, prima gli italiani, yeah, but quali italiani? And so, yes, this was what I was trying to do. Thinking also about what Marie was saying, la normalità si eredita per sangue, and how this is complicated, because even if you have the heritage of that blood, like in my case, a very Italian name and surname, Italian blood, but somehow there is another category going on in the picture. And so I thought this was really important for me to highlight. Thank you.
I just wanted to thank everyone for just coming here and giving us so much enlightenment. I have a question out of curiosity, and was wondering if, like, in, you know, Italian food, like, being so famous and in, I don't know, worldwide recognized, as well as fashion, is there like signs where we see like mixing of or influence of African culture or our immigrant culture? And what I have observed is that whenever, you know, these influences happens or these mixes happens, like, people are more okay with that, or, you know, might tend to appropriate. So I was just wondering if, you know, this influence is seen either in fashion or in food, or like things that are considered like very Italian, and how do people like react to that when you know, you might say to someone, hey, like, you know, actually the root of this is, it's, or, you know, the influence of this is, it's this or that.
we want to talk about food, the ironic thing is that, you know, most of the foods that we think of as quintessentially Italian do not come from the Italian peninsula. Tomatoes, no. Pasta, no. Corn, no. Like, none of it. Eggplant, none of it. I mean, a few things, but a lot of it, right, came from elsewhere. I did a lot of work with Black Italian entrepreneurs during my research, so looking at women who are really active in the Black natural hair movement, in fashion and style. A few years ago, two Black Italian women launched the first ever Afro Fashion Week in Milan, right? Saying Milan is the fashion capital of the world. That's actually also Ades Tesfamariam in her chapter also talks about sort of the politics of beauty in Italy, because she also works adjacent to the beauty industry. So we are seeing, you know, we're seeing this happen in all these really interesting ways. You know, these projects that are, you know, bringing together, say, you know, wax cloth textiles, right, with Italian sartorial techniques, or, you know, there are a couple brands now of made in Italy hair products for Black women with natural hair. And these projects are really interesting, one, because they are, you know, evidence of a kind of cultural creolization, right? And a reminder that, you know, like, Italy's not white. Italy has also never been white, right, if we you know, want to get real. But at the same time, they make this interesting political intervention, you know, because of the moment that we're in, like Prima gli Italiani, all of these things, you know, there's this idea that to be Black is to be a drain on state resources, right? To be Black is to take away money and resources and jobs from quote-unquote deserving Italians. And so, you know, for better or worse, right, because we could make an argument about, you know, neoliberal citizenship and racial capitalism in this as well, but these kinds of projects show, like, the kinds of really creative cultural and economic contributions that Black Italians are making and the ways that they are remixing and transforming Italianness and infusing it with these different kinds of diasporic sensibilities in really, really exciting ways. So if you're interested, we can definitely name drop some very cool Black Italian designers who are doing some great work right now.
I would like add just a little story, because you said the typical Italian dishes actually are not Italians. We could say also the opposite. We had Matteo Salvini making a campaign against the couscous. We won't be invaded by couscous, and actually it is a Sicilian dish.
Thank you very much. I'm Italian, an old white Italian man, so I'm learning a lot of things about from you. I was wondering, you know, in Italy, we also had a problem of color between the south and the north, I terroni. So when the immigration from the south went to the north, they were different from color, okay? Also, if we remember, the United States divided Italian from southern. Are they white? No, you know, are Italians white? And the northern Italian. So in your perspective, do you feel that Italians are different by colors from the north and the south, and dealing with you? And how do you feel that with the idea of racism in terms of color, depending on also, because I was wondering that Italy has a long history of racism in this sense also. So it's really difficult to understand for me everything in this way, because when you say Italy, you said before, Salvini, I hate the idea of thinking Salvini represents Italy. Salvini represents a part of Italy, a small part of Italy. But it's true that the problem of racism comes from the north, the left, to the right, to everywhere. So it's really complicated for me as white, old Italian man to understand all these things.
I think maybe it's important to distinguish race from color. This is, for me, is important, because if you think about Italians who migrated to the US, they arrived in Ellis Island, what are you? And Italian and Irish being called very paradoxical names like white, N-word, which you think, how is that possible? But it really tells us how they were biologically white, but socially Black. And I think in Italy, southern and northern, you know, this discrimination racism also has this impact along with other factors like class. But then what happened that even if you are socially black, at some point your race takes advantage. And so this is what happened with Italians and Irish. They were living with African Americans. They were living in the same neighborhood, doing the same job, being paid the same. But then at some point, Italians and Irish start to get rights. They can vote. They can get certain trade licenses. They get certain jobs, while African American stays at the bottom. And so I think to see how color is really not your color, is the social stigma that you may have that has been historically created. And in Italy today, I think it's interesting to see, if you think we are talking about Salvini, we have seen how he changed the name of the party. It's not anymore Lega Nord, it's now Lega. And this was very smart move because he was saying, we are all white Italians, and we are all united against the new other. And so this really tells us how this distinction is still really relevant.
And I think this is key, right? The renaming, you know, from the Lega Nord to the Lega. I mean, you know, this is effectively what Mussolini did as well, right? Mussolini said, we're not northern and southern Italians. We are all, you know, la razza ario mediterranea. Right, as part of a process of uniting the people of the peninsula in contradistinction to the people of the continent, right, the people of the African continent. And I think as well, you know, we were talking about this earlier, if we want to tell the story of the racialization of Southern Italians, we still have to talk about Africa and blackness. If we think about Cesare Lombroso, Lombroso was writing about Southern Italians and he was theorizing the racial inferiority of Africans, right? Because there was an assumed proximity between them. And so knowledge production about Southern Italians was knowledge production about Africans and blackness. So these stories are intertwined. I don't think we have to think of it as a, you know, Southern Italians versus Africans, but rather as a, you know, it's a trans-Mediterranean story of race making.
Kind of to follow up on that, Sicily was once referred to as the northernmost province of Africa. And so it's been very odd to hear Sicilians jumping on the anti-African bandwagon. And it's just very odd to see this kind of racial turnabout. And wondering if you have some thoughts on that.
Just to carry on about Sicily, actually, what you said made me think about one of the founding fathers, Luigi Farini. He, when they went to the south, he said he was shocked, and he said, "This is not Italy. This is Africa. Even the Bedouins, compared to these peasants, are more civilized." So. And these were the founding fathers, right? So just to say the massive cultural divide that was going on at the time of the unification. And Sicily was really mentioned a lot in this, in Lombroso, but also in pseudo-scientific treaties. The Sicilian's blood is genetically criminal. So there was a lot of genetics and heredity going on.
The question about southern Italy, racism in Italy, is also an economic problem. Let's think about agriculture in the southern Italy today. Who are the most exploited peasants? Black migrants, often with undocumented. So we have to understand how race works in order to let an economic system reproduce itself. Today in Italy, we have a race line granting Italian economic system to develop because of the fact that some jobs that Italians don't do anymore are done by people on the unprivileged part of the race system. I think about agriculture, I think about domestic work. Badanti, le badanti in Italia, in Italy, are not Italian women as a structural data.
So just to follow up on this, I feel that it's really interesting what you've all been saying, and to connect it to kind of recent migrations, for instance, these processes of racialization and how, for instance, in the early 90s, the Albanians were considered people of color, right? And then today, the Albanians are the sort of model minority. So it's interesting to see how these categories are very much shifting and socially constructed, which is also, in many ways, a signal that there's hope, right? And this kind of work is extremely important in that sense. So related to this, I wanted to ask you, because it's true that in Italy there is this terrible lack of historical consciousness. You've been talking about the colonial amnesia, and all these issues are just not discussed. They're just not part, unfortunately, they're not part of the, you know, the public discourse. They're not talked, I mean, they're talked about, fortunately, because of this kind of work and because of Igiaba Scego and many others. But again, I feel there needs to be a broader movement. So I was wondering, and I keep thinking about, you know, school and education and those kind of initiatives. So I wanted to ask you about this kind of work and this kind of activism, this political, literary, journalistic work. How is it being carried on in, you know, from below and also in the educational system?
Thank you. Yes, that's very important. I would like to say, though, that in the last 15 years, there's been an incredible movement of new young historians really focusing to dismantle this colonial amnesia. So we had the production of a number of pivotal texts, academically speaking, like Postcolonial Italy, Bianco e Nero, a number of collections. So at the moment is really academia. There are certain clusters like Padova, for example, where we try, they try to do it. It's true, there is a lack of certain disciplines. As I said earlier, I had to go abroad to do gender studies because it didn't exist. Now we have actually gender studies is almost banned. We have this gender ideology where certain comuni banned, especially if they're governed by a certain political party, they ban certain texts, because otherwise your children can become homosexual. And so there is a lot of, it's quite astonishing to think we are at this stage, critical race theory, so it doesn't exist. But what I was reiterating early, there is a lot going on. So I think in the next few years, really, we're going to see a big shift. The problem is the institutions, they really don't help. So they really try to perpetuate this narrative. So when you put on the TV today, you still see only white people on TV, like if non-white Italians do not exist. But then you go in the streets of basically every Italian city, town, village, and you see color being around. So there is a sort of, will not to show. Mm-hmm. And this is perpetrated by the media a lot. There is a lot of resistance to open this debate with the institutions, but yeah, we are trying.
I just wanted to add on top of what Angelica said that I think that using existing materials online, such as interviews with Afro-Italiani, are great materials to use in the classroom and to help students learn more about just the multiplicity of realities that exist in Italy. And as we've heard today, there's, stories and reflections that Angelica, Marie, and Camilla shared, there's this longing and curiosity to learn more. And when you share with other students about
what's taking place across the ocean, I think it helps bridge that gap for students that it's not just happening here, it's happening elsewhere. And I think that's really important to help students just build a stronger connection with the language that they're learning.
Please join me in thanking our four guests. They've come from Santa Cruz, from Milano, from Firenze, and from New York.